Welcome students to our new lecture on quantum chemistry. We will be dealing today with black body radiations. These are the series of new lectures on based on the topics quantum chemistry. First, let us understand the nature of radiation through which this quantum theory came up into existence. So to understand the nature of radiation, Newton in 1680 propounded the corpuscular theory that could well explain the rectilinear propagation and reflection of light. So Newton's corpuscular theory was good enough to explain the linear propagation of light, as well as the phenomenon of reflection of light was explained very well by Newton's corpuscular theory. There were other experiments also which were not being explained by Newton's corpuscular theory. Those were like interference, diffraction. These experiments were not being able to explain by the Newton's corpuscular theory, like interference, diffraction, polarization. But in the similar same period, Huygens came up with a wave theory of light, where accordingly the light was made up of, or was assumed to be made up of waves. And with this phenomenon or with this theory, he could explain the interference, diffraction, as well as the polarization phenomenon, along with rectilinear propagation of light and reflection of light. And because of this, this theory was widely accepted. And for almost two centuries, this was the only theory that was widely accepted for the nature of, or explaining the nature of radiations. But later on in year 1864, Maxwell came up with electromagnetic wave theory and showed that all radiations are made up of electromagnetic waves, or they are in electromagnetic in nature and have same speed in vacuum. All radiations were assumed to be traveling with same speed in vacuum, and he showed that the radiations propagate in the form of waves with their electric and magnetic fields perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So that if this is our direction of propagation of waves, this will be the electrical field and this will be the magnetic field. So that we will have the magnetic field associated exactly at perpendicular direction to the electrical field, and also perpendicular to the direction of the propagation. So if this is our electric field associated with waves, and this one the magnetic field associated with the waves of light or waves of radiations. Maxwell's theory could explain many phenomena that were present in that, and he could unify the phenomena of electricity and magnetism in the form of four equations that were given by him, which were later on known as Maxwell's equations. And these were unifying the electric and magnetic fields. The electromagnetic wave theory was given a sound footing by the Hertz experiments, where in the laboratory he could detect the waves, and he produced and detected the waves in the laboratory in the year 1887. So that experimentally proved the Maxwell's electromagnetic theory. But in the similar time, there were certain experiments that were came up, like black body radiation experiments and many other experiments were that came up, which could not be explained by any of these theories, like Newton's corpuscular theory, Huygens' wave theory, or Maxwell's electromagnetic theory, could not explain those experimental observations. But so to explain those observations, Max Planck came up with a radical theory called as quantum theory. We will study it one by one, those experiments. The four main experiments that came up and which resulted in failure of classical mechanics are the black body radiation experiment, photoelectric effect, Compton effect, and atomic spectrum. We will see the three of them one by one in each of the lectures. In this lecture, we will concentrate on black body radiation experiment. Next lectures, we will see about the photoelectric effect and Compton effects. Let us see first on the black body radiation experiment. A black body, by definition, is one that absorbs all radiations incident on it, or conversely, it is the one which is when heated to a temperature, say T Kelvin, would emit radiations of all frequencies. That is, it can act both as a sink for absorption of radiations, as well as it can act as a source for radiations. So it can act both as a sink for radiations to absorb the radiations, as well as it can act as a source of radiations. The black body, if it is heated to a temperature T, it would emit radiations of all frequencies. The radiations given out by a black body depends only on the temperature to which the black body is raised, and it is assumed to be independent of the nature of the body. That is, it has nothing to do with the nature of the body, the material with which that body is being generated or prepared. It depends only on the temperature to which the body is being heated. Looking at this particular black body radiation experiment, there were many scientists which came up to try to explain this particular experimental observations. That is, black body can emit radiations depending on the temperature to which it has been raised to. And in doing so, the first one came up in 1884. Stefan and Boltzmann tried to explain the black body radiation experiment and showed that the energy of the radiation in a unit volume, of space due to all wavelengths in the spectrum is proportional to the fourth power of the absolute temperature of a black body. And this came up, or the energy of all the radiations that are emitted by the black body is proportional to T to the power of 4, which further came to be known as Stefan's fourth power law. Further, there were other experiments also being done, and depending on the results that were obtained from Stefan's fourth power law, there were plots being generated of energy density versus wavelength for radiations emitted by the black body at different temperatures. In this particular graphs, we could see that the x-axis is wavelength, which is increasing in this direction, or we can say that the frequency, which is related to wavelength, will increase in this direction, and the energy, which is related directly to the frequency, will also increase in the opposite direction. So frequency and energy will increase from right to left, while wavelength will increase from left to right. Our y-axis is energy density, which is defined as the radiation energy per unit volume per unit wavelength interval. That is, for a wavelength interval of say delta lambda, what is the amount of energy that is being emitted by the black body per unit volume of black body? How much energy is being emitted by the black body is measured along the y-axis at particular intervals of wavelength being plotted along the x-axis. From this particular graph, what we can see is that the energy density increases with increase in frequency. As we increase the frequency from right to left, the energy density keep on increasing, and it goes to a maximum and then falls to back to zero. So it goes to maximum and then falls to zero. When we increase the temperature of this black body radiation, then what we can see is that as the temperature is increased from say 4000 Kelvin to 6000 Kelvin, the maximum point of maximum also shifts towards the higher frequency or lower wavelengths. Point of maximum is shifting towards the lower wavelengths or shorter wavelengths or the higher frequencies. As we increase the temperature further from 6000 Kelvin to 18000 Kelvin, it is further shifted towards the blue side. This at 4000 Kelvin, we can see that the maximum is at around 700 nanometer, which is in the red region of the visible region of electromagnetic spectrum. This gives us a red line or red colored radiations. And at 18,000 Kelvin, it is having a maximum at 400 nanometers, which gives us blue colored radiations. And that is why we have plotted this with blue and this with red color, intermediate with a yellow color. So what we can say is that as the energy density increases with energy density, as the frequency will increase, the energy density also increases, passes through a maximum and then falls to zero. Similarly, when the temperature is increased, the maximum point, the point of maximum shifts towards the shorter wavelength or higher frequency, or shifts towards the higher energy. These observations were then further tried to explain by many different scientists, and the notable contributions came from three. The first amongst them was Wien's. Wien gave us in 1893, gave the explanation for this black body radiation. And in arriving in order to explain the distribution of energy in thermal spectrum from thermodynamic consideration, he deduced a equation rho equals to, that is rho or energy density equals to 8 pi square h nu cube upon c cube into e to the power of minus h nu by kt, where nu is frequency of radiation, c is velocity of light or velocity of radiation, then k is Boltzmann's constant, t is absolute temperature. So he deduced this particular equation, which is came to be known as Wien's radiation law, and this equation is in good agreement with the experimental curve, but only at shorter wavelengths. That is, the experiment that we had it, where we had plotted energy density on y-axis and lambda on x-axis, our experimental observation was something like this. With Wien's law, it could give us at shorter wavelengths, it holds good, but then it will be deviating a lot. So there are a lot of deviations at higher wavelengths or at lower frequencies or higher wavelengths. There are a lot of deviations are observed, but it holds good at shorter wavelengths or higher frequencies. So this Wien's radiation law holds good only at half of the spectrum or half of the experiment. It holds good. The other half, it deviates a lot. Then encouraged from this particular observations, Lord Rayleigh and Jeans tried to explain it in a different approach, with using a different approach. They treated the radiations inside the black body as standing electromagnetic waves. A black body is something like this, where if the radiation enters into it, it is remaining inside the black body itself, so that it gets absorbed in the black body. So in this case, what we can say is that they can be understood or can be estimated or assumed to be standing waves. So that was the assumption of Lord Rayleigh and Jeans, where they assumed that the radiations inside the black body as standing electromagnetic waves, and they computed the number of modes of vibrations per unit volume in the frequency range of nu to nu plus delta nu as 8 pi square nu square d nu upon c cube. If the black body cavity is in thermal equilibrium, each standing wave has a mean kinetic energy of kT, where k is Boltzmann's constant and T is absolute temperature, then the energy density for that black body can be given as 8 pi nu square kT upon c cube. So this will be giving us the energy density of a black body whose temperature has been raised to T degree Kelvin. This is known as Rayleigh-Jeans law, and it is in good agreement with experimental results, but only at higher wavelengths or lower frequencies. That is when we go for the experimental observations, where on y-axis we have energy density and on x-axis we have wavelengths. This was the experimental observations. Rayleigh-Jeans law holds good at this particular region. And then it deviates a lot. So there it holds good at the higher wavelength region or lower frequency region, while what we had observed it for Wien's law was it was holds good at the lower or shorter wavelengths. Lord Rayleigh himself predicted that the energy density goes to infinity as the wavelength is decreased or as the frequency is increased. Frequency is as it is in the numerator. So as the frequency is increased, the energy density goes to infinity. And this particular thing happens in the ultraviolet region. In the ultraviolet region, according to Rayleigh-Jeans law, the energy density tends to infinity, which is an absurd result or which cannot happen or unimaginable result. And as such, this is known as ultraviolet catastrophe. That is, in the ultraviolet region, according to Rayleigh-Jeans law, the energy density increases to infinity or it goes to infinity. Hence, from Wien's law as well as Rayleigh-Jeans law, what we can say is that the both of them holds good at half of the experimental observations, but none of them in the whole range of wavelengths. Only half of the wavelengths they were holding good. And the Wien's law was good for the shorter wavelengths, and Rayleigh-Jeans law was good for the higher wavelengths, but none of them were good for the whole range of wavelengths. So in order to explain the whole range of wavelengths for black body radiation, Max Planck came up with his quantum theory and tried to explain the black body radiation using his quantum theory. Max Planck proposed in 1901 the explanation for black body radiation, and according to him, the energy density variation can be given as 8 pi h nu cube upon c cube into 1 upon e to the power of h nu by kt minus 1 into dv. We will not go for the derivation of this equation, but just we will see that this particular equation, when we consider it at larger frequencies, at higher frequencies or shorter wavelengths, what happens is that when the frequency is very large, this particular component e to the power of h nu by kt is having h nu upon kt, which will be much higher than 1. And because of that, e to the power of h nu by kt minus 1 reduces to e to the power of h nu by kt. And hence, this particular term goes into numerator as e to the power of minus h nu by kt, which is very much similar to Wien's law. So that the energy density equation reduces to Wien's law. And hence, at larger frequencies or shorter wavelengths, it holds good, as the Wien's law also holds good for shorter wavelengths. In case two, when the frequency is small or the wavelengths are large, longer wavelengths are there, in that case, h nu by kt is much smaller than 1, and hence e to the power of h nu by kt minus 1 will reduce to h nu by kt. And as it reduces to h nu by kt, here we will have rho density into d nu equals 8 pi h nu cube upon c cube into this particular term now reduces to h nu by kt. So 1 upon h nu by kt will be equal to kt by h nu. So this nu, one of the nu goes, h can cancel over here. So we will get this energy density as 8 pi nu square by c cube into kt d nu. So this is nothing but Rayleigh-Jeans law. So we get a Rayleigh-Jeans law at higher wavelengths or smaller frequencies. So this Max Planck's equation or Max Planck's law of radiation is similar to Wien's law at higher frequencies and is similar to Rayleigh Jean's law at lower frequencies. Hence, this holds good for a whole range of wavelengths. Hence, at higher frequencies, Max Planck Planck's law reduces to Wien's law, and at lower frequencies, it reduces to Rayleigh Jean's law. Hence, it is applicable over a whole range of wavelength. It gave a new idea of discontinuous emission of radiations. According to Planck's theory, the radiations are emitted in the form of energy packets called as quanta or quantums, and which according to classical physics, they were as a continuous waves. As they were continuous waves, so a body can emit or absorb any amount of energy. But according to Planck's hypothesis or Planck's theory, energy emitted by a black body is restricted to an integral number of a certain minimum energy called E is equal to h nu. This is known as quantum. So it can have energies either one packet of energy or two packets of energy. It cannot have intermediate of these energies. So it can have a certain levels of energies only. It cannot have a continuous type of energy. Hence, the Planck's law of radiation gave us a discontinuous emission of radiations, gave us an idea of discontinuous emission of radiation, which gave the basis for atomic spectrum. So it could explain the atomic spectrum very well because of its discontinuous emission of radiations. So this was for black body radiation experiment.